My God is so much bigger than troubles I face. Why would I hunger for power, riches, or fame? Oh, 'cause my God is so much better than all of these things. So I...
It's the only note that I have, so...
Yeah, there's not another guitar here. As long as it's in tune with itself, we'll be...
Yeah.
Say, we are the same. sinners sing.
Might not be Easter morning, but those words are true every Sunday. And so when we picked this song, I was just so excited to just take a song and just appreciate that sacrifice on Calvary. And Jesus, we're here this morning, and we're excited to worship you. We're excited to feel your presence this morning in this space. Father, we can't express enough how grateful we are for what you did for us, Lord, and what you continue to do for us every day. And Lord, we just love you. And we just sing in your name. Amen.
A place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sins washed white. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white. I owe all to you, I owe all to you. Here my hope is found, here on holy ground. Here I bow down, here I bow down. Here, arms open wide, here you save my life. Here I bow down. Surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white. I owe all to you. 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 Jesus.
Rule number one of singing is to not put cough drops in your mouth, but
your solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old, and your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledged yourself to me, and it's why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. You're making me like you, and clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride, free of all her guilt, and rid of all her shame, and known by her true name. And it's why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, worthy are you, Lord. And it's why I sing your praise with ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips.
There's a line in this song, still this rage inside of me. And I think I'm not always honest with myself, I guess, of how often that can become a pattern of thought for me. It's just, I'm a pretty docile guy. I'm just a singer, but sometimes in my head, you know, just you get those days that just bring out a rage that you kind of, I might not show it, but I can feel it, and I feel the way it kind of wears on me. Just having this moment in this song to sing it to God, that I want him to come and just still my soul. I don't know if there's somebody in here that kind of feels that same way, but I just know that, for one, you're not alone in how you feel, but more importantly, you're not alone. You have a Father who loves you and will just kind of remove that rage. And I've found that if I pray in those moments and just take a second just to acknowledge that Jesus is still there, it just calms in a way that's so profound and supernatural that you can't help but meet Jesus in that moment. Breathe.
storm surrounding me, let it break at your name and still call the sea to still. It's raging me to still every wave at your name, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Breathe, call these bones to live, and call these lungs to sing once again. I will praise Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. No. Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Silence my fears, oh Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light that my shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome.
I don't like to talk after songs like that.
Okay. Hey, everybody. What's up, guys? Oh, man. Yeah, the men's bathroom. No, I'm just teasing. We're actually just praying for a beloved sister in the back, and I just love that. We gather here not to go through the motions, not to just put on a show. We gather here for the purpose of ministry. And so, with that being said, our sister in the back, she's not the only one that needs prayer. How many of you need prayer this moment because you're going through something? There are mountains before you. Maybe you're walking through a valley and it feels maybe like the valley of the shadow of death. Maybe you're struggling with doubt, depression, anxiety. Maybe there is an ailment in your body. Maybe a generational curse that you're asking delivery from in the name of Jesus. How many of you need prayer? How many of you actually just woke up just on the wrong side of the bed and right now you're just downcast? Like, it might not be anything too heavy. You're just in a bad mood. How many of you need prayer? Okay, if you did not raise your hand, you're a liar. But liars are welcome here, right? This is a messy, broken church. We need Jesus. I'm just teasing. But the point is, I think we all need prayer. Hey, so let's just spend a little bit of time, and let's open up communion in this moment. So in the back of every chair, there's a packet. It looks like this, and it's double sealed. The top seal is for the wafer. The bottom seal is for the juice. Ask your neighbor if you need a little bit of help opening this, because some of you guys have contractor hands, and this might just be too thin for you, and I get that. So we're going to spend a little bit of time praying for each other, but before we do that, we're first going to take communion. Because God's love fills and flows from available and open and willing vessels. So we are so blessed to be ministered by our brothers and sisters, but our brothers and sisters are not the source. Jesus is the source of that blessing. Jesus is the source of this ministry. Jesus is the source of your healing. Jesus is the source of your comfort. So before we go to our brother and sister, we're going to go straight to our Lord, our risen King, Jesus. Jesus, I thank you that you know everyone in this room. You know them by name. You saw them before you even wove them in their mother's womb. You know how many hairs are on their head? You know the details, the intricate details of their life. You are the ever-seeing, sympathetic high priest who knows firsthand our weaknesses. And you make intercession for us. Jesus, we go to you. We give you our anxieties. We give you our burdens. We give you our fears. We give you our suffering. We place everything at the foot of the cross, everything at your feet. Church, let us take and eat of the bread and remember Christ's body that was broken for you. Take and eat. Take and drink the juice, which represents, symbolizes, and expresses the very blood of Jesus shed for you for the forgiveness of sins and the freedom from sin to give us life. Take and drink and remember him. Praise him from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts.
Thank you, Jesus. Hey, if you need prayer, healing is experienced not only directly from Jesus, but through brother and sister. And so just right now, maybe with the folks that you came with, maybe the friends that you see, and honestly, even if we're strangers, we're brother and sister to each other today. Let's just spend a little time. You can move around chairs, form pods, but let's just pray for each other. Could be a 10-second prayer. This could last just a couple of minutes. But let's pray for one another. Alrighty, I don't want to interrupt you, so please feel free to continue to pray if you're still praying with your neighbor. But at this time, we're going to dismiss our preschool and elementary kids back to the back of the room. with their teachers, and their teachers are going to bring them to their classrooms at Kidstown. So if you're in preschool and elementary, you can be dismissed. And right now, church, I just want you to take a look at these kids. I love you. I love you. Go with mama. I just want you to take a look at all these kids that are meeting in the back with their teachers. In church, I just took a walk over at Kidstown just a moment ago. We are bursting from the seams in our kids' ministry. Okay? I had someone once tell me in regards to the local church, if it ain't crying, it's dying. Okay? And there are so many little kids. First of all, I just want to invite you guys. If you have not been a participant in our kids' ministry serving once a month, I just want to invite you to please be a part of it. We're literally bursting from the seams. And every little bit of help helps a lot. Okay, so I just want to invite you into that. But secondly, as we just saw all these kids leave and kids in the nurseries just bursting forth from the seams, I just want to remind you again that it's not Holy Spirit in this room and Junior Holy Spirit on the other side of the wall. It's not church and JV church. These kids are part of the church. They're the church of today and the church of tomorrow. And we want to be a church that is representing every age demographic, every generation. But we also want to be a church that's very, very intentional about raising up the next generation of Jesus followers. Okay, so can we just pray a blessing over our kids? Lord Jesus, thank you for the abundance of young families, of mothers and fathers, of children, all of whom you love. And we just ask that you give every kid just a sensitivity in their heart to your Holy Spirit and a desire in their innermost being to abide with you and to obey your will. Oh, Lord Jesus, you said, bring the children to me. Don't stop them. Don't hinder them. And God, may we be a church that doesn't hinder the kids to freely experience your love as we gather. But may we be a church that brings them to you. We pray this in your name. Amen. Hey, let's greet one another if you haven't yet. And then we have a special invitation from Mark and Katrina. So let's greet one another if you haven't said any hi to anyone around you yet. And I can't wait for you guys to hear what they're about to share. All right. So our mission statement here is to build a community that's built around Jesus. And we feel like this is a twofold approach of both gathering on Sundays around a stage, but also gathering sometime throughout the week around a table, gathering in each other's living rooms, that we don't just go to church, that church isn't something we go to or attend, but that church is a reality of community in the spirit that we experience. And so with that, we have community groups, and I just want to invite you that if you are willing, and maybe even right now, just you can start to feel an excitement well up to host, to carve out a day, a time in your home to host just a gathering of Jesus followers that you guys could worship him and be encouraged by him and read about him and seek him. An hour or two in your home just to carve out an intentional gathering of the saints. That's so important. Because I know about you guys, but Sunday morning is awesome, okay? And I leave and literally it's like Sunday afternoon. I'm like, oh man, I'm really struggling. I need my church family. Like just hours later, right? We're not meant to gather just one time a week. That's like eating one time a week, okay? I can't go 4 hours without getting hangry. Okay, we need the nutrition, the benefit, the experience, the encouragement of gathering as the people of God. So if you're interested in leading a community group, just carving out a day and time in your week to just host a gathering of the saints, can you please let us know? You can fill out the response card to the chair in front of you and just turn it in at the welcome booth on the way out. But we're going to do something really exciting this year. We're hosting a group that has a specific focus. Mark and Katrina, come on up and share with us the heart and the focus of this particular group. Can you guys welcome Katrina, Mark, Heronin? And standing at 6 foot, no, okay. I just got the mic, man. Let's go.
Right on. Thank you, Joey. I also just want to say thanks to Jess and Brian for chasing us down and holding us accountable to the discussions we've been having about what you're going to hear about this morning. So thank you guys. Really appreciate that. This is my beautiful wife, Katrina.
Hi.
And good morning. Good morning. So we just wanted to, and I want to just take a few moments and just kind of let you guys know about a small group that has sort of been percolating in our brains. It's been percolating around the church, and it's been affirmed and confirmed in many ways in discussions with the leadership team. And so with all of that, and then again, Brian and Jess chasing us down and holding us accountable to the purpose of this, we're here. And so we want to tell you a little bit about it. So, okay, thank you. How's that? That's so difficult. How do you do that, right? That's why Joey has that one pegged to his ear. I know, man. I need it. So we wanted to just, again, take a couple minutes to let you know about a small group for engaged and young married couples that we're going to be launching in a few weeks, along with our co-leaders, Charlie and Kim Smith. Charlie is in the back taking care of kids, doing the thing, right? That's cool. He's very gifted at that kind of stuff. I just wanted to recognize them. Nearly 30 years ago, Katrina and I were invited to join a young married Bible study led by a couple named Bob and Sue Groff. Great business leaders, served in the church, just great salt of the earth people that had a passion for young married people. Little did we know how blessed we were going to be by being mentored and shepherded by those amazing people. Our group included six couples. We were the seventh. And they became essentially like extended family to us. We walked through tons of stuff, weathered a variety of storms in life. We walked through them together. We prayed for each other. And offered support. And by God's grace, today, I can tell you all seven of those couples are still married. Still married. And because of that experience, we've often asked ourselves, one day, are we going to pay that forward, right? And so today's the day. We've wrestled with this as my career has moved, and we've moved to different places and been at different stages in life and tried to, wrestle with, is it the right time or not the right time? But Again, as I mentioned, it's been affirmed, confirmed, and again, Jess and Brian have been chasing us down. So we really don't have an excuse anymore. So the goal of the group is to strengthen our marriages while growing in our faith and reliance on God. The vision of the group is to shepherd younger couples, walking alongside them through ups and downs of marriage as they build community and connection with other married and engaged couples who are at a similar stage in life. We will cover a variety of marriage-related topics, applying biblical truths along with the wisdom that we have gained through our tumultuous journeys. And I say that, tumultuous. Standing here, completely imperfect, willing to take this challenge on is, you know, it's heavy. But the encouragement for those of you that are wrestling, your heart's racing, and you're thinking about, am I going to join this group? Just know, we're not perfect, either as Kim and Charlie, but we do life together, and we're sanctified, and God just, he takes us on that journey one step at a time. So, that's a beautiful thing. Just look back and remember where you were and where you are today. God's grace is so good. So what can you expect from this group if you decide to join it? You can expect to be loved, to receive compassion, build strong connections for your leaders, Katrina and I, Kim and Charlie, to be as transparent about our lives as we possibly can. I think that's super important as we walk this journey. To have a safe place to share joys and trials, to be prayed for, to acquire new practical tools and biblical perspective about challenges you might be facing today or in the future, to have a network of people to rally around you, and to have fun. The tentative plan for us is to meet at Charlie and Kim's house every Monday night. We don't know if we're going to do this on a weekly basis or a bi-weekly basis. That's to be determined, so we're sorting that out. So more information to come on that. And then I just would like to say, if this sounds at all interesting to you, we invite you to prayerfully consider signing up. And we look forward to being on this journey with those of you that would be interested. That's meant a lot to us. And even this week, you know, that group that we started 30 years ago, there's a text group, and we're talking about real life stuff there with Bob, and Sue has since passed. But what an amazing group of people to do life with. So thank you for your time. And at this point, Katrina's going to handle the scripture reading for today.
For those that are able, will you please stand with me? Today's reading is from Psalm 46:10. He says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." This is the word of the Lord.
Praise be to God.
Thank you.
Thanks, brother. Thank you, guys. Thank you guys so much. Well, be with Jesus. Become like Jesus. Anyone want to finish it for me? And do what Jesus did. There we go. Come on. This is what Laurel Church is all about, because honestly, y'all, this is what discipleship to Jesus, being his apprentices, is all about. But before we jump to becoming like Jesus and doing the things of Jesus, we have to first learn how to be with Jesus. We have to first learn how to be aware of and engage with and abide in his gentle and holy presence, just as a branch abides in the vine. And one of the greatest ways to do this, one of the greatest ways to be with Jesus, to sit at his feet and be fully present before him, is by entering into prayer. And prayer in the Christian tradition, simply put, is the anytime, anywhere access we have to commune and to converse with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.
And this gift of union and unrestricted communication is ours all because of the victory Jesus has won on our behalf. So to say it again, prayer is one of the most powerful practices to be with Jesus, and it's Jesus himself who actually modeled this for us. Luke 5:16, it says that Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. Why? To be with his Father. Even when the pace of life and the demands of ministry ramped up, Jesus never compromised or cut back on the time he spent with Abba Father. After a long day of teaching, preaching, and healing, we read in Mark 1:35 that the very next day, early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. You see, in his humanity, Jesus' own need to withdraw from the demands of the pressures of this world and to be with his Abba was such a priority. And the prayers he prayed as he communed with Abba were so radically personal that his disciples couldn't help but ask their rabbi, "Lord, teach us to pray." So Jesus did. And here's what's cool. The words of prayer and the forms of prayer that Jesus taught his disciples were powerful, yet simple. His teachings on prayer were pulled from Hebrew tradition and the long library of Scripture, yet the prayers themselves were actually fairly short. In fact, Jesus told his disciples not to pray these long, eloquent, sophisticated, and repetitious prayers like the pagans who thought that they would be heard for their many words. He actually called such prayers babbling in Matthew 6. And with those words of Jesus in mind, the 19th century preacher C.H. Spurgeon taught that, quote, "short prayers are long enough." I feel like some of us, we have this pressure to even begin the conversation of God because there's so much to talk about. And Spurge Dog, he's just saying, just begin to talk with God. Okay, it doesn't have to be long or sophisticated. You don't have to use like a form of language that you don't actually use all throughout the day to talk to another human being. Just talk to God. Just begin. So this fall, we are refocusing on being with Jesus through the gift of prayer. And it's my goal to equip you with short prayers that you can actually find in Scripture. Prayers that can help tether your heart to God when you're feeling distracted. Prayers that can help anchor your soul in grace when it's been a chaotic day. Prayers that help you realign to Christ's royal law of loving God and loving others as you love yourself. Short prayers that you can easily recall in your mind, engrave on your heart, and have readily available on your lips. But the short prayer that we're highlighting in this morning's teaching and in this week's practice isn't actually a prayer that we say. It's a posture we take. It isn't a prayer we speak, but a prayer in which we listen and know. So here it is. You just heard it. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Slow down. Quiet your soul. And be still before God. This is where prayer starts. Now, some of you in this room, you might be thinking, slow down my life, still my soul. I don't have time for that. My friends, that's the point. And I think right now, as some of you are squirming, I can actually see you. I think that the level of resistance to the idea of silence and stillness before God is actually the indicator of how badly you need it. Tyler Staton is a pastor in Portland that I listen to and glean from, and in his book, Praying Like Monks, Living Like Fools, he says that our resistance to stillness and silence is largely due to the fast-paced, overly busy, modern Western lifestyle, a lifestyle, he observes, that is a product of three groundbreaking inventions. the clock, the light bulb, and the iPhone. The clock. In 1370, the first public clock was set up in Germany. And historians say that this was the turning point between natural time and artificial time. You see, most people would wake up as the sun rose and would go to bed as the sun set. There was a natural rhythm to life. But with the invention of the clock, time went from being a natural, healthy limit that governs our day to a resource used to further our individual agendas. The light bulb. In 1879, Thomas Edison invented the light bulb. This invention increased human productivity greatly and decreased human sleep time just as greatly. Prior to the light bulb, listen to this. This is absolutely mind-boggling. Prior to the light bulb, the average American slept 11 hours a night.
Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus, come. But a study done in 2013 showed that we are down to 6.5 hours of sleep a night. And with less sleep and more productivity, guess what took off? Technology. In 1960, central AC and heating, microwaves, dishwashers, laundry machines were all common appliances in most American homes. With all of this productivity and the trajectory of technology, almost every sociologist predicted that it would lead to more leisure time and ease of life. In 1967, a Senate subcommittee predicted that by 1985, almost just 20 years later, the average American would work 22 hours a week for 27 weeks a year. Like, that's how effective and efficient and productive we were becoming as a people. But in reality, leisure time decreased by 37% during that exact same period of time. Now, in one sense, they were right. Technology did move things along quickly, and it did free up more time, but they were wrong about how we would spend that time. The iPhone. In 2007, Apple released the first iPhone. Now, today, the average iPhone user touches their phone over 2,500 times a day, stares at their phone for over 4 hours a day over the course of 76 sessions per day. So instead of slowing down and enriching our souls with all of this extra time and all of this amazing technology, mental health professionals have diagnosed countless people with this diagnosis, hurry sickness. Hurry sickness, which is a term that describes a behavioral pattern that is characterized by continual rushing and anxiousness. Does this sound familiar to y'all? You see, in a society that values efficiency and productivity above anything else, hurry is no longer an occasional necessity. Let's be honest, there's just times we're going to have to hurry and hustle. But it's no longer an occasional necessity. Hustle and hurry has become the new normal. It's the constant mode we're stuck in. And may I say, it is a spiritually dangerous new normal. What did God remind King David to do in a time of tribal warfare where he was busy leading an army to defend their country and to defeat their enemy that was camped out just over the nearest hill? Be still and know that I am God. Fast forward to modern times, the late Christian philosopher Dallas Willard was once asked, what is the one thing a person can do to deepen their spiritual life? And after a long pause, Willard replied, you must ruthlessly eliminate hurry from your life. Theologian Richard Foster has stated that our adversary majors in three things: noise, hurry, and crowds. So if the devil can engage us in muchness and manyness, he will rest satisfied. A journalist once asked the 20th century monk Thomas Merton to diagnose the leading spiritual disease of their time, and Merton responded with a one-word answer: efficiency. The late Holocaust survivor Corrie Ten Boom is recorded to have simply said that if the devil can't make you sin, he'll make you busy. Even Jesus himself weighed in on the matter. Matthew 16:26, Jesus says, what good will it be if someone gains the whole world yet forfeits their soul. So there you have it. An ancient Israelite king, a philosopher, a theologian, a Holocaust survivor, a monk, and Jesus himself all saying the exact same thing. Be still. Slow down your soul. Be with God. Now, I think it's easy to blame people or policies or agendas when it comes to the current spiritual landscape of our day. I think we all do it, and certainly that has an effect. But what if busyness is actually one of the biggest enemies to a deep, rich spiritual life with Jesus? In 1942, Christian author C.S. Lewis wrote a novel titled Screwtape Letters. And in this novel, Lewis uses his biblically shaped imagination to climb into the minds and schemes of Satan and his demons. Listen to this excerpt. Satan called a worldwide convention. In his opening address to his evil angels, he said, "We can't keep Christians from going to church. We can't keep them from reading their Bibles and knowing the truth. We can't even keep them from forming an intimate relationship with their Savior. Once they gain that connection with Jesus, our power over them is broken. So let them go to their churches. Let them have their covered dish dinners." Again, this was in the 1940s. "But steal their time. So they don't have time to develop a relationship with Jesus Christ. So this is what I want you to do," said the devil. "Distract them from gaining hold of their Savior and maintaining that vital connection throughout their day." "How shall we do this?" his demons shouted. "Keep them busy in the non-essentials of life and invent innumerable schemes to occupy their minds," he answered. "Tempt them to spend, 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 and borrow, 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 persuade the wives and the husbands to go to work for long hours so they can afford their empty lifestyles. Keep them from spending time with their children. As their families fragment, soon their homes will no longer offer the escape from the pressures of work. Overstimulate their minds so that they cannot hear that still, small voice. Entice them to play the radio or cassette player whenever they drive. To keep the TV, VCR, CDs, and their PCs going constantly in their homes, and see to it that every store and restaurant in the world plays non-biblical music constantly. This will jam their minds and break that union with Christ. Fill the coffee tables with magazines and newspapers. Pound their minds with the news 24 hours a day. Invade their driving moments with billboards. Flood their mailboxes with junk mail, mail order catalogs, sweepstakes, and every kind of newsletter and promotional, offering free products, services, and false hopes. Even in their recreation, let them be excessive. Have them return from their recreation exhausted. Keep them too busy to go out in nature and reflect on God's creation. Send them to amusement parks, sporting events, plays, concerts, and movies instead. Keep them busy, busy, busy. And when they meet for spiritual fellowship, involve them in gossip and small talk so that they leave troubled and not encouraged. Crowd their lives with so many good causes that they have no time to seek power from Jesus. Soon they will be working in their own strength, sacrificing their health and family for the good of the cause. It will work. This will work. And decades later, my friends, we have to ask, is this working? Now, I want to make one thing clear. Ignoring and overstepping our God-given limitations in an attempt to be more, do more, want more, and have more isn't just a modern Western problem. This is an ancient problem. Living too fast, too full, with all this felt pressure to be productive, to perform, achieve, and accomplish, only to feel burnt out, exhausted, overextended, and spiritually malnourished are all symptoms of a deeply rooted problem, a problem that began in the garden. As the devil was tempting Eve to take and eat of the forbidden fruit, he said to the woman, "You will not certainly die. For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So instead of trusting and submitting to their God-given limits, Adam and Eve, they crossed those limits in order to be like God on their own terms. Instead of being content with who they were and what they had, content with the boundaries and limitations that God had set for their good and for their flourishing, they wanted more. And their decision to overreach their hand in order to have more ushered in a brokenness that runs so intrinsically deep within the human race. Ever since Genesis 3, my brothers and sisters, we struggle and sin in the same way our ancestors did in the garden. We think that we can be like God on our own terms, that we can know more and do more and produce more, achieve more and be more. We begin to think that we are God, and if we slow down, if we even consider it, or step back, or even stop certain things, then the world, at least your world, will fall apart. So you sacrifice time with your spouse and your kids to work overtime at your job, because where would your goals be without you? Or you say yes to every possible opportunity to help every needy person in the name of Jesus, because where would they be without you? Or you do the things that you already don't have time to do, because if you said no, then what would others be thinking and saying about you? Or you feel like you need to post your weekly controversial comment on Facebook, because where would the social media world be without your two cents? You see, we often attribute the pace and hurry and anxiety of life to what's around us. We think that our outer environment is restricting our inner environment, our minds, our hearts, our souls. But what if our outer environment is mostly the projection of our inner environment? In other words, what if our busy and restless lives are mainly a result of our rebelliously restless heart? What if, to be honest, we don't want to spend time with God, and so we make ourselves busy to avoid him? Because we know that his healing cuts deep and it hurts, but it actually makes us whole. And that's a hard, difficult, lengthy process to walk through. And so we want to avoid it. And now we don't have time for God. What if the reason you and I are so physically fatigued, emotionally drained, and spiritually malnourished is because we think, as Adam and Eve did before us, that we can strive to be like God on our own terms? That we, who are finite, can literally run a pace of life that only one who is infinite can actually run. And therefore, we think that we can take God's job to running our lives for him. What if the majority of our overcommitted and overhurried pace of living actually comes from a place of pride? And what if the truth that can counter this lie, what if the antidote that can cure our hurry sickness is actually to simplify our lives, still our souls before God, and remind ourselves that God is God and that we are not? That we can just be God's children and let God be Father and King. David writes in Psalm 131, verses 1 through 3, "My heart is not proud, Lord. My eyes are not haughty. I do not concern myself with great matters or things too wonderful for me. But I have calmed and quieted myself. I am like a weaned child with its mother. Like a weaned child, I am content." An unweaned infant screams and wails about desperately looking for their mother's milk. But my friends, a weaned child has learned how to be content and to trust their mother for their next meal. And so it is with our spiritual life with God. David writes that when we become prideful, we actually begin thinking of too much, saying yes to too much, attempting to do too much. We begin to spiral like a screaming, unweaned infant. And it's only by humbling and quieting ourselves before God that we learn how to trust him for our next spiritual meal. And therefore, we begin to live calm and content lives in the midst of a chaotic world? Are we flailing about like unweaned children? Or like a weaned child, have we learned to be content with who God has made us to be and what he has already given us? David writes again in Psalm 39, 4 through 6. He says, show me, Lord, my life's end and the number of my days. Let me know how fleeting my life is. You have made my days a mere handbreadth. The span of my years is as nothing before you. Everyone is but a breath, even those who seem secure. Surely everyone goes around like a mere phantom. In vain they rush about, heaping up wealth without knowing whose it will finally be. After dropping off Bubba Man at kindergarten, spent some time with my two girls. And we spent an hour at the 10 Mile Cemetery. And we visited where Harold's body lay. And we thanked God that his spirit is with Jesus and that one day Jesus will come back and give us new bodies and raise us from the dead. And then we just walked. We spent an hour in the cemetery. This was one of the most humbling, quiet times I have ever had with God. To remember, as I look at all these tombstones, that my life is fleeting. The length of my days is but a breath before the eternal one. Why am I striving about, rushing about, sacrificing what really matters for the sake of what? To be known? To be accomplished? To have a lot? Even when all I gain will end up rusting and be garbage one day anyway? As I was walking through the cemetery, I kind of played this game with my girls of like, who was, like, what's the oldest tombstone here? This all sounds super morbid. I promise you, it was really enriching, okay? I came back as like, oh yeah, we just like took a stroll through the cemetery. My wife's like, what's wrong with you? There's a tombstone that read, Father Amos Reed, born in 1810, died in 1894. And I looked at that, and I heard the still small voice of God. And I had a moment with Jesus. And as I looked at that date, died in 1894, I would be born 98 years later. Father Amos Reed, he was a man of ministry in Whatcom County. He was a part of and then would later pass along what now I have stepped into. Amos Reed and myself, we are connected. And yet, 98 years later when I was born, and all these years later after I've grown up, I know nothing about Father Reed. Nothing. And I felt the small, still voice of God say, hey, Joe, 100 years after you die, no one will remember you too. Now, this isn't like self, like deprecation, like woe is me, I'm trash. Far from it. That was one of the most freeing truths that God could whisper to my heart. Because I have attached so much of my identity to what you think of me, to my accomplishments, my doing, how I am perceived among the public. If I'm doing a good enough job, if I'm quote-unquote successful as a pastor, none of those things matter. And 100 years from now, no one will even remember what I've done. I am fleeting. When we rush about seeking to overreach and overstep and overcommit and overhurry, it is from a place of pride ultimately. Contentment comes from knowing that God is God and I am not. He is the eternal one. I am finite and fleeting. I experienced peace in that moment in the cemetery and peace for the rest of the day. the rest of the day, that was Friday. Friday night, we'd take a charter bus to Chelan. I'm around a whole bunch of sneaky teenagers. Y'all had peace. We lost 21-20 the last few seconds of the game to Chelan, those stupid goats. And as the coaches are freaking out and the players are throwing their helmet, I'm like, hey, it's all fleeting. On that day, I had so much peace because I spent time in stillness and silence before God. And my pride, my ego, my false self was utterly humbled to nothing in that moment. And yet my soul experienced the reality of though I am fleeting, I am seen by God. I am loved by God. You see, my pride, my ego, my flesh, my false self, as church fathers would say, my false self, my pride, my ego, it wants the noise. It wants the attention. The kids would say, it wants all the smoke. It wants the recognition. It wants to be busy. It wants to be hurried. It wants to look impressive and important to others. It wants the praise and the approval of man. It wants to think that my worth is based on what I do and what I have and how others see me. My flesh, my ego, my false self is hell-bent in keeping a God complex that I can do more and be more than who God created me to be, that I can run my own life, that I can be everywhere and do everything as if I'm the infinite one, as if I'm God. But when I am still and silent before God, y'all, I can't achieve by works. When I'm still and silent before God, I can only receive grace. When I am still before God and silent before him, I can't be seen by others, only by the one who truly matters. When I'm still and silent before God, I actually can't impress or be applauded or look awesome because I'm in the presence of the one who knows all things and who holds all things together. Silent prayer is a painful experience because my pride is dying in the presence of the life-giving God. I talked about stillness and silence last year. I had some of you guys literally tell me you were mad at me. You were joking, and it's all a good time, but you are supposed to squirm when you are silent and surrendered and still before God. You're supposed to squirm. You're supposed to be uncomfortable because your false self is being shed off. And your new self in Christ is emerging. I am not defined by what I do or all that I think that I am. I'm defined by who you tell me I am. Who God tells me I am. Saint Seraphim of Sarov taught, absolute silence is a cross upon which a man must crucify himself with all of his sinful passions and desires. In other words, stillness and silence are the two beams of the inner cross upon which my ego is crucified. And even though our ego dies in silence before God, our souls become alive. In silence, we become increasingly aware that we are dust, but equally aware that we are seen, loved, valued, treasured, and pursued by God. David writes of this in Psalm 8, 3 through 4. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. This is the part of David's prayer of silent prayer, really, that crucifies the ego. Who are we? And yet, David didn't stop there. Here's the part of silent prayer that breathes new life to your soul. He writes in the very next verse, in verse 5, yet you have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. Who are we? And yet you love us. And we bear your image. That is an honor. That actually humanity was originally made to be co-rulers and intercessors, partners with God. Who are we? And yet, in the eyes of God, we're his beloved. Though we are dust, God has given us his breath. Though we are lowly, God has made us in his image. Though we are fragile clay jars, God has tucked away within us the treasure of his spirit. Silence before God, as awkward, as uncool, as ordinary as that sounds, silence before God in contemplative prayer reminds us and transforms us by both these realities. We are dust, and we have his breath. Henry Nouwen, I've read some of his stuff. I'm like, why do I like him so much? He was a Dutch theologian, that's why. He says, solitude and silence. If you ain't Dutch, you ain't much. Just saying. No, dude, I'm just teasing. Paul says that if we're in... I know. The motherland! Okay, sorry. We're all one in Christ, okay? Okay. Henry Nouwen says, solitude and silence is the furnace of transformation. Without solitude and silence, we remain victims of our society and continue to be entangled in the illusions of the false self. Solitude and silence is the place of the great struggle and the great encounter. The struggle against the compulsions of the false self and the encounter with the loving God who offers himself as the substance of the new self. Psalm 46:10. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I'll be exalted in the earth. Here's what's cool. Jesus would escape. Jesus would retreat. Jesus would leave crowds and go into the eremos, the wilderness, the lonely place, the solitary place. He spent quiet time with Abba. Here's what's really cool. He didn't stay there. He would reemerge back on the scenes, back into the public. He needed it, the quiet, to be able to go back and do what he did, ultimately to set his face upon Jerusalem to carry his cross. When we are quiet and still before God, when our false self is crucified and our new self in Christ emerges with life, we can actually go back to the world, back to the people, back to the places, with such a peace and a contentment, knowing that none of those things define you. You are already defined as one seen and loved by God. Now do your work. Now do your thing. Now be a responsible steward, but live from that place. Church, what if we prayed with stillness long enough to know and remember once again that he is God? That in Jesus all things are created and in Jesus all things are held together. What if we prayed with stillness long enough to know that Jesus, he's the one who took all of our mistakes, our pains, our wrongs, our errors, and he said, it is finished. What if we prayed with stillness long enough to remember that Jesus, he's making all things new? That Jesus has an everlasting and unshakable kingdom, that Jesus is fighting for his bride, that Jesus will be exalted among the nations, that Jesus will be exalted in the earth, that Jesus is God and King, and we are not. And thank God that we are not. We are free to be loved by Jesus. Prayer, after all, as Philip Yancey describes it, is the act of seeing reality from God's point of view. So here's the practice of this week. Whenever you spend your quiet time with God, begin with silence. For some of you guys who are just talkers, instead of diving right into prayer, take 3 deep breaths and just be with God. And then begin to speak. Usually when I come home from work, I get into the most trouble when I just start doing all the talking to my wife. And she's like, dude, can you shut up and do the dishes? Like, can you help me? Or I do all the talking and it's been hours and I haven't even asked her about her day yet. Prayer, my friends, is a conversation. Some of us are too busy talking at God, let alone with God. Are we listening to him? So before you pray, before you spend the next little moment of your quiet time with God, can you just give God the first word? Can you let him begin to speak to you? Can you give the Holy Spirit the time to pour the love of God into your heart? Romans 5, that's the ministry, baby. Start by being silent. It will be awkward. It will be painful. That's a good thing. Let's not be too busy for Jesus. Worship team, you can come back up. Now, my little sheep. Also, I'm included. I know that I'm a shepherd, but I'm part of the sheep that always like tries to jump the pen. Before we even practice this in our week, let's practice this now. And it is okay if you hear a sniffle or a cough or a cell phone go off. It's okay. Right now, can we just lay down our agendas and our egos and just be his beloved? Just be loved by him. Let's just practice this for 30 seconds. And then we can be loud and noisy again with a worship song. Let's do this.
On ahead in my own strength, and you're right here, Lord. I wanna love like you. I wanna feel what you feel. I wanna see what you see. I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice. I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking. You see, I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice, I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking. Open my eyes, I want to see you. Open my ears, I want to hear you speak. Tell me your thoughts, what's on your mind. And I'll be your friend, I want to see through your eyes. I want to see through your eyes. To your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice, I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking. I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice, I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking.
Okay, so normally we come up here and we say two things. So we got a response card. If you're new with us, please fill out a response card. And if you've been here, there's also opportunity for prayer requests. And then we also do, we tell you about this handy dandy little weekly flyer. Now this is the test. What's different about it this time? There's a backside. So that's something new that we got. So you guys didn't really pass that, so I'm a little, you know, okay. No, this has everything you need, and on the back side is what I want to tell you guys about. So we had the opportunity to have the Meridian staff here for a wonderful breakfast, and we gave them the opportunity to fill out wish list form, telling us of items that they might need in their classroom that their budget doesn't necessarily allow them to have. And also an opportunity for them to give us like prayer requests and stuff, and it was just awesome to see these teachers' prayer requests. Well, we finally got the list finished, and it's up on Amazon under our registry. So that is one way to give. You can go onto Amazon, and if you feel led to purchase an item, we just need them purchased by the 17th. If Amazon's not your thing, online's not your thing, there's an opportunity to, if you want to donate money, then we can do the shopping for you. I don't mind that. Or there's a few items that we actually physically need donated that are on the bottom here of some of the things that the teachers have that are wishing for. So that's that.
Well, hello. My name's Micah, for those of you who don't know me. If you've read on your little pamphlet that she puts out, that we're having a camp out next weekend here on the church grounds. Crystal kicked off one back in the spring up at Silver Lake. And how many out there came to that camp? That's pretty good showing there. So we just thought one more before the season ends and the cold starts and everything. And the kids went back to school, but now they want to still play. So it sounds like we're going to have a blow-up slide there from the bounce houses on Saturday. It'd be potluck Friday when everybody shows up after 3 o'clock. So I think we're going to have the church open if we need to use restrooms, things like that. Power will be of something here. I'm sure we can get 110 here and there for those. I mean, it's camping or glamping. It depends on how you want to look at it. I'm glamping. I'm not in a tent. But if you can't camp, feel free. Come out on Saturday. We're going to have from 10 to 12 on Saturday. I'm calling on the men here in the church. Women too, but women, I praise you. You do a lot in this church. I'm calling on men. We're going to do some more cleanup here for a couple hours. We have all the branches that are still hanging down over on the Meridian High School parking lot. Would love to just get those brought up, and I'll have a dump trailer here, things like that. So we just put a couple hours into working. We have a leaky gutter at the front door that everybody sees when it's pouring down rain. We're going to address that, cut that tree back. It's growing into the gutter. And just a time of fellowship. You know, I enjoyed this camp out just being new to this church back in December. And I'm from Meridian. And the fellowship that went on at that camp, I encourage you to come out and visit with us. And like I said, can't camp, bring your lawn chairs on Saturday. Sunday, we're going to come right out of our campers and into the church and just fellowship again. So hope to see you there.
And during the camp out, Meridian actually has a football game that Saturday. We're hosting a team that's pretty close to Portland, very south of Washington. They're coming up on Saturday. And then we're going to kick their butts, and then they can drive home all the way. So if you want to get some entertainment and watch your pastor lose his mind on the sideline, you can feel free to come there, too, as we camp together. Thanks, guys, so much for being here. Just a reminder that in 10 minutes, we're going to come back in here for all the covenant members of our church, those who have been here for a while, who are invested, who are involved. There is a little sheet of paper, too, that just kind of indicates in our system if you're a covenant member. If you've been here a while, if you're involved, if that's you, but you haven't signed that covenant member sheet, it's going to be available at the welcome booth as well. 10 minutes, covenant members back in here, just a few things to talk about, budget, board, the process of looking for another associate pastor here. So if any of those things intrigue you and you're not a covenant member, you can be welcome to stay and go to the meeting. But there's a couple things to vote on, and one, I think, actually, to vote on. And that'll be reserved for the covenant members of our church. So in 10 minutes, we'll be back in here. But for all of you that aren't going to stay around, love you. Thank you so much for being here. Go in the peace of the Holy Spirit and the power of Jesus. We love you guys. See ya.